What's up, people? Today's day 245, making Songbringer. Today I'm making the charged attack. It's going to be sweet. This is where the player will hold down the button for a second and then hold down the attack button, release it. A giant, like, charged beam of energy hits the ground. Lots of enemies in the radius around it are damaged by that big blast. What's up, Pedro? Huh? Boogie, what up? Yeah. I guess Jib should be a lot smaller, right? To put him in scale. Run the damn game already. Yeah, so it's something like where you'll have another button for this new ability. Oh wait, I think I'm supposed to go like this. Is there any echo? Did I leave the page on? Oh, and by the way, does it change your guys' volume if I change my volume? Like, I'll turn it up, like, really high. This is pretty high. Wow, too many windows. You have to stand up all day? Whoa. Ah. Oh, so you, oh, crazy. You're standing too, man. Nice. So, there's this volume. What's going on in the game? The volume here. Man, what I need in this game is a button which takes me in and out of windowed mode. Or setting or something like that in the game. What's up, Rocket Bunny? I'm just wondering if the sound works. In the game. So we'll go into windowed mode. Gotta make that a setting. Ah. What's up, guys? Welcome to the stream. Okay, so if I crank up the volume. Alright, so it's hitting like negative 12, 10. And then if I crank, I put the volume all the way down. Oh, it's the same volume for you guys, right? Yeah, awesome. Great, great. That's good to know. Yeah, just started to stream today. Today I'm making the charge attack. So this is where the player, you press the attack button. You hold it down for a second, and then you release a really big blow. What's up, Arcane? Nice. Good, good. Man, it's so good to have actual audio working now. All right, so let me get the starting animation. I think is going to be... I might just do all animating today, because this might be a really big graphic. But let's see. Rock is lifting the sword. Maybe this one too. I'm gonna kind of base it off of how he already lifts the sword. How you guys doing today? What's up? Happy Happy Halloween. It should still be Halloween for you guys, right? Do you guys have Halloween? Yeah, nice, man. Made progress on your Huffman encoding. It's good to know. Good to know. Huffman encoding, I mean, it's a good thing to know. Not that I would know. The most I know about encoding is RLE. It's really all the encoding I've ever done. I know there's a lot better encoding algorithms out there. How exactly? What's the basics? What's the basic premise of Huffman encoding versus something as simple as RLE, run length encoding? You thought it was a mailman? Oh yeah. So it's this one right here. This is the right animation to use. All right, cool. We're gonna start with this one. Save it as something else. We're going to call it the Charge Sword East. I think this might be such a big animation. I don't know. We'll see. But if it is a really big animation, I might only do East. And that also counts for West. So there wouldn't be a special North version of this attack. Or maybe there will be. Who knows? Whoa. Oh no. Huh? Oh, did I mess the stream up? Hold on. If I go to the Twitch stream, maybe it didn't get my game development thing. No, that's right. I don't know. Okay, so just getting started here, basically. Okay, so yeah, I want to draw an animation where he lifts the sword into the air. This is going to be a big animation. Like, light is going to shoot down. So let's get this all set up so we're ready for this. I'm going to get rid of this color fill thing. I really only need one background. Get rid of these existing frames. And make this bigger. Like, this could be up to 240 pixels tall. Hey. Oh, this is canvas. Yeah, canvas size. And wide. I don't know. Not half the screen, but maybe a quarter of the screen. So that's 105. 106. Let's keep it even. There. Okay, so that's about how big I want this canvas to be, right? That could be a lot of light shining down on this thing. But I think it'll look crazy cool. Oh, really? Uh-huh. Weird. I wonder if this is a problem with Game Show. There is a new Game Show they just released. It's like 1.1, so maybe I should need to get it or something. What's up, Lucas? Cool, man. Welcome to the live stream. You can say anything, and I say something back. All right, so maybe it's best to actually start with an idea of how I want this all to be at the very apex of this energy, right? So I'm just going to draw a bunch of energy. Let's loosely base this energy off of this hue right here, though. Let me get rid of the timeline view so I got a bigger like view to say stuff. So yeah, let's loosely base this next hue off of that. Nice, right on. It seems more real. Yeah, it's like you're seeing with 3D glasses, man. Yeah. What's up, KX? Yeah, we got a Jib. We got Rock. We got the top hat. Of course, we've got Zelda. I don't want it to be too zoomed out. All right, so this hue, a really bright hue, something way less saturation. That's probably pretty good. But yeah, this guy's cool. It's like OS Sloth. He's my favorite. Okay, so you want to encode a character A. It takes one byte. All right, Huffman creates prefix codes based on frequency of a character in the text. So in this case, it can assign one to A, which is only one bit. So it's a one bit frequency. It's unreadable when you code it. You need some dictionary with those prefixes. Right. You need to know all those prefix codes. I get you. So wait. So it def okay, let's say, so basically it works like this. Like, you assign a prefix code of one to A. And then so you need all those prefix codes as like a dictionary before you can go decode it. I get it. What's up, man? I'm making art right now. I got an Xcode window open. I just ran the game a second ago to test something out. But yeah, I'm gonna be making mostly art today. So this is gonna be where the player, wait, is the sound off? Sound off? It's not very loud for me. Oh, I can turn my volume all the way up now. This is great. So, what was I saying? Losing track. My cactus, yes. Yeah, so anyways, the sword attack is going to be one where you hold down the attack button, you build up some energy, and then you release like a really big attack. Yeah, exactly, RLE, right, yeah. Right. Right, the prefixes get longer the more characters you have in the dictionary. Yeah. So every prefix is a unique entry. I get you. Simple. Thanks for explaining that to me in a very nice, simple way. I think I understand. I get the gist of Huffman encoding now. Okay. Let's draw like so some, this is gonna be like the apex of this attack is where there's this big old like surge of energy. Oops. Why didn't that work? Oh, you're killing me here, man. You're killing me. Oh, did that? Oh, I think I drew in this the wrong layer. Oh, well. Yeah. Which is only 3 bits for that, and then maybe like 6 bytes for that dictionary. Yeah, and yes, I like this too. I like to be taught things. Yeah. Okay, so I can just ditch this layer now. Yeah. Ditch that layer. Tell me why it is not filling. This is kind of the one thing I don't like about Photoshop, is sometimes you can get lost. You can't really figure shit out, right? You should be able to figure your shit out. It's like there's too many ways to do the same thing in Photoshop. So sometimes you get confused, which way should I do this? Right? It's one of those pieces of software that tries to be everything to everyone. Bunny, what's up, man? The hell? Oh well. Yeah, happy Halloween. Saturday. There's probably a lot of people doing Halloweeny stuff right now. It's probably why there's not many people on the stream today. We got some Halloween parties tonight, but since I'm on the Pacific Coast, it's really early for me. Time's it. This is another thing. Why are the three things that I need to use often all look like time icons, right? The time, the backup time machine, and flux all look like a freaking clock. Which one is it? Which one is it? Which one's the time? Which one's flux? See, it's only 3 o'clock here. That's what I'm trying to say. All right, so let's give this shit some real wham. Oops. Yeah. Oh, you don't have Halloween? Oh, see. There I go, assuming again. Awesome. Okay, so what do you guys have any kind of holidays where everyone dresses up in costumes? That's basically what it's like here on the Pacific Coast. Everybody dresses in costumes and parties. Little kids go around and they have bags, sacks ready for candy. And they go to all these different places and like people's houses. They walk around neighborhoods and everyone's got candy already ready out in their little bowls and stuff, and kids can come up and take candy, or sometimes they have to knock on the door and say trick or treat, and they give them candy. I'm sure you understand. You already knew, but like that's kind of how it is here. You guys have anything like that? And the rotten teeth. Oh man. Oh. You have crazier stuff than that? Really? I've been to the Czech Republic. I like it. I've been to Prague and Lake Bolaton. I loved it. I got my first tattoo there. You don't have it in Poland either? What the? Man. Somebody needs to write a letter. This is kind of a fun national holiday we got here. Man, I feel privileged now. I hope we get some tonight too, man. We don't typically in our neighborhood. Whoa, you create Will-O-Wisps? Great. Yeah, that sounds awesome. Oh man, I did it again. I keep drawing on the wrong layer. There we go. What? Dude, I keep doing this all wrong. Whoa. There, dude. Man. Jeez, there. All right. All right, all right, all right. This is like the energy. There. Hopefully, if I label this, I'll remember what layer I'm on. Yes. That's what I want to see. I want to erase some pixels, man. Yeah, I'm getting to that. I'm getting to that. So I'm just kind of like doing this sort of negative thing. Onto this edge because I think it'll add a lot of interest to the edge. I'm gonna eventually blur this all, so I'll kind of create like a glowing effect or something like that. Want to see if this is looking good. That's what I was imagining. Yeah, with a blur, I think this could look really cool. What about something like this? Some of these. Yeah, that's cool. Nice. Tablet. Tablet for sure. Without the tablet, like, I'm so much slower. A mouse is so slow. But with the tablet, man, I can go so fast that you could be anywhere on the entire screen in a second because it's absolute distance, right? So your tablet, you can t if I'm put my cursor here, it's at the bottom left of the screen. Up here, it's the top right of the screen. So you can instantly go from one part of the screen to the other. And it's just way more natural for actually drawing stuff. If you're used to drawing with a pen, then like it's just way more natural to do that and quick. You know, it's quicker. It's a good tool. Save you time. What's up, Marza? Welcome, man. How's your day going? Happy Halloween if it is Halloween for you. I've been learning that Halloween is not a universal thing. Not in the UK either? What? You do have it? Oh, thank God. At least you do have it. You do have it in the UK? And Italy? That's great. Great news. So wait, what's it like though? Is it maybe it's not great news? What is it a good Halloween? Is it fun to is it, people have fun with it? Oh, yeah. So what do people do now? Nice. Cool. Nice. Okay, cool. What's it like in Italy, Marza? Oh, yeah. Right. You know what? This is probably not going to look that good actually with a flat line at the bottom because, you know, this is supposed to feel more three-dimensional. Give it some depth. You know? Yeah, right, isn't it? Wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8? 8, maybe? It's so close. Maybe I just need to take one off this side, huh? I think I'm maybe putting a big circle in the middle. Wow. Ooh, man, that is tempting to just change the whole thing to a circle. It's so nice. Hold on a second. Let's do a proper experiment. So if this was a circle, maybe like that. It's kind of cool. Oh, it's kind of cool. Okay. So let's make it so we can compare the two. Oh, it's kind of nice with both, actually. Yeah, it's definitely coming out on the App Store, man. Yep. It's gonna be like way cheaper on the App Store, actually. But the touch controls, right? Do you want to play with the gamepad or touch controls? Sweet, Rocket Bunny. Nice concept. I totally, yeah, all those fixes and stuff were because I adapted it into Songbringer and I had to do in this and that to make it a little bit just work with, you know. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, the plan's always been to put it on the App Store. Yeah, iPad, iOS. Yeah, and I'm thinking about using this porting company to get it onto PlayStation 4 and Xbox and Wii U and PlayStation Vita, and they would also do Android too. So it's kind of tempting deal, man. It's like, why the hell wouldn't I? Why the hell wouldn't I try and put Songbringer on as many platforms as I could get it on, right? Yeah, is it you about to comment another line there? Is there a plus in this equation? Yeah, but I hear you. Yeah, some of the original press that that Songbringer got was saying the same kind of thing. It's kind of like comp. It's kind of like, oh, and Dungeon Souls. Interesting. Interesting. All right. No worries. Okay, so debating. Oh man, I like this actually. Yeah, and this circle can grow and stuff. Oh, what? Okay, so this is a 70. That's 60. I want like 68. 68. That was hard. Oh, that's cool. Kind of came out like a crescent, sort of. All right, now let's go. 66. What, a different Dungeon Souls? Wait, what? How could there be two games named Dungeon Souls? Or wait. Oh, sorry, I was thinking of Dark Souls. Never mind, never mind. Yeah, I saw this one before. Dungeon Souls. This looks more multiplayer, though. Yeah, I've seen this one. Dungeon Souls, right. Thanks for clarifying. I get things confused a lot. Sorry, everybody. I used to call PewDiePie. What did I call him? I forget now. That's good, right? I actually remembered something. PewDiePie. Ooh, oh, it's kind of cool. Think I want to try one more layer. So this one, instead of 70, we'll do 74. And then delete 72. Yeah. Oh, this is looking awesome. I'm liking this. PETA! You're in Portland? It's raining? Well, it's late October in Portland for sure. Yes. Oh, yes. All right, let's do another one. 78. Yeah, that's a crazy cool distortion right there. How one of these layers moves one pixel to the right, another layer moves one pixel to the left. It gives it this cool feeling that it's almost moving like that, like a snake. I think it's because it's Halloween, and there's like everybody is doing stuff. That's what I'm assuming, I guess. Okay. This is good enough for like first frame. We keep it kind of dirty and just like put it all in its own folder. Case I want to come back and change all these layers. All right, so this is the frame where he's like got his sword in the air, sort of like a rough draft, right? And then now let's do the frame where he swings it all the way down and shit goes crazy. Have I heard of a game Riot? What's that? You mean this game? Yeah, I've heard of this. I've seen their Steam page. I think it's on my wish list. Looks awesome, man. Yeah. Okay, so we really are gonna need a lair where he's just like this, the sword. Could you make tutorials on YouTube? Of course. Are you asking me if I will? Azurus, what's up? Yeah, that's the point. It's supposed to look big, really big. What's up, Blood? Welcome, welcome. I'm gonna grab a couple of these East frames where he's swinging the sword. Because I wonder if there's one that kind of works for. The sort of ending frame of this animation, right? There's that one where he's like, no, that's not really the motion. Maybe actually I could. Yeah, actually maybe that one will work. And then is it difficult to make a pixel game built in a 3D environment? Nope, it's not. It's really easy. It's actually almost easier than making a 3D game in a 3D environment because 3D games and 3D environments require lots of work on your meshes and stuff. You know what I mean? You got to create all of your 3D models and everything in three dimensions. But if you're making a pixel art game, all you gotta do is really slap up some pixels and put a couple squares and you're good to go, right? You can even write code that freaking generates that for you. You don't necessarily even have to go and draw all those pixel, or create all those pixel graphics as models. So, it really simplifies it. And it's actually a beautiful thing to do because you can use 3D lighting effects in your whole game. With the pixel art, so it's kind of be a really nice complement of styles, right? This two-dimensional pixel-y thing with these 3D effects could be cool. Like Legend of Dungeon, if you've seen Legend of Dungeon, this is by Robot Loves Kitty. They did it in Unity, right? So you don't even need like. You don't even need, I mean, it's free software these days. You can make Unity games. This is all you need to make a game like this with all these awesome, see this? Great pixel art mixed with really dramatic lighting effects. What's it like down in California? We got perfect weather right now. Yeah. It's been really cold at night, but other than that, we haven't had any rain. Same. It's like it's really, bad drought. Yeah, so this one might work if his body wasn't in this sort of crazy state. Let's see if we can transition him through two of these frames into what I'm imagining for this whole charged attack thing. He's just basically, he's lifting up the sword and then he just brings it straight frick down. Explosion. Yeah, well, I mean, I wish we were having rainy days right now. We need water so bad here. Anybody know any gods that can make it rain? That'd be really nice. Maybe some, athletic stars that can make it rain. I'm just going to modify this thing, this frame, to make it kind of in the flow of this animation here. Looks funny like that. Okay, so that's one potential for about how that frame might look. How did you discover me, man? How did you find my secret identity? Whoops. Oh, that's a really, really big cursor, huh? Right? Huh. You know what? This is not exactly what I was thinking for this frame. But I think I'll start over here in a sec. Yeah. Okay, so anyways, we got two possibilities, right, for how this thing will come down. So, right, starting from this position, let's do it. I'm gonna do one from scratch where we just like where focus on that end result I was thinking of rather than using existing stuff. Okay, so the sword I want. All the way on the ground. Okay, the hero's knees are gonna be bent. All right, let's draw some new arms. Thinking if you like sword over there and slam it down on the ground. Like, I guess anything you really have with your left hand. All right, so posture. Nice. How'd it go? Nice, you won. Do I follow any sports? No. No. I follow art, though. Like a lot of sports. I love sports. I think I love going to games, you know what I mean? I love everything about it. But I just don't really have the time to follow sports. You know what I mean? This is a full-time thing. More than full-time. This is an all-consuming life thing, being an indie game developer. It takes up all your time, basically. How does it feel having been talking alone to a screen for 245 days? Well, in my mind, I really haven't been talking alone at all. Been talking to you guys. Lots of you people. So many people watch the stream over these 245 days. Starting out, there was like nobody there. There was a couple friends, right, that actually came on my stream. Some of my actually good friends from college and stuff were like, yo, what's up? You have a stream? Sweet. That was nice. But then, you know, 60, 90 days into it, people started to like the art and the game started coming together. And then now, you know, to like 128 days into it, we did the Kickstarter, and thanks to you guys, in a lot of senses, that thing succeeded. You guys got it off to such a good start. And it was thanks to your great feedback and everything too, from, you know, how to modify the page, the Kickstarter page, to like choices for how the rewards should be, you know, to making the video better and all those kind of things. And so a lot of this project's success is thanks to you guys. And then, you know, continuing on past that, the last 100 days or so have been amazing too. It's just been really fun to develop this game, knowing that there's already some people that are stoked to play it. I proved the market validity of this product, if you look at it in a business sense. Which is something that I feel that indies don't do enough of. And in fact, I wrote a whole article about it, and it's going to be coming out on Gama Sutra. And I wanted to get you guys' thoughts on what the title should be, actually. Here's some of these titles I thought of. One was Prove It, an Indie Guide to Market Validation Before Time Investment. Two, Is Your Indie Game Worth the Time? And three, Prove Your Indie Game with Crowdfunding. So I'd love to get some thoughts on which of these sounds like an article you would read, because all these kind of hinted what the article's about. But yeah, it's going to be coming out on Gama Sutra this week, like Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday or something. you never talk back to the screen? I see that. I know what it's like to watch other people's streams. But yeah, I know what you mean, right? It doesn't feel weird at all to me, because I guess I'm actually talking. Yeah, yeah. You watched that. That's great. You tried yelling at the screen a couple times? You know what? I've always thought that, like, it'd be so cool to hear your guys' voices somehow, sometime. You know? I don't know how the hell that would work, right? Would it be like push to talk or something like that? But that's why it's really interesting to meet you guys in person. Marza and I had a got together around WWDC last year in June. Or this year. No, this year. Yeah, this year in June. I always forget what year it is. But anyways, one of these titles will do, I'm sure. Okay. Did I answer the question? Yeah, I answered the question. All right, cool. All right. Okay, man. You think the second title goes straight to the point and works better as an eye opener? Yeah, yeah. Is your indie game worth the time? Really? The whole article is about basically that as indies, a lot of times our games fail. There's a lot of failed postmortems out there. And people say, oh, but I had good marketing, I had good stuff, but I didn't verify that people wanted to buy my product, buy my video game, you know? And you can prove that an indie game is worth the time you would invest into creating it by running a crowdfunding campaign and seeing if people will actually buy it, you know? Yeah, so I will definitely put this link out there. This is my Kickstarter post. I've been calling this my Kickstarter post. Ever since I did the Kickstarter, I've had a post I've been working on about how you could do your own Kickstarter project or a crowdfunding project on Indiegogo or whatever. And I've just finally come to the point where I've got to get it out, because there's so many articles I've seen about failed indie games, and they didn't verify this very simple thing. Will people buy it before they spent years? So we're talking like an indie team of students, whatever, working 3.5 years to create the game Airscape or whatever. And they only sold like 100 copies at the very end of, and they had great marketing and everything. They did a good job of marketing their game. They did a great job making the game. It's actually a pretty cool looking game, but it just didn't sell. So nice. Yeah, right on. Yeah. Yeah, so but that goes for, you know, anybody that's here, if you're in the Bay Area, in the San Francisco Bay Area, and, you know, feel free to hit me up. We might have a beer or something. If and when I finish my game, could you help me market it? I can help you help yourself market it, yes. But no, I won't market it for you. But yes, I will tell you everything I possibly can about how you can market your own game. But sorry, I'm a little bit too busy to market anybody else's game. I know, right? How many times did you drive across it trying to take pictures of it? So crazy. It's targeted for the indie game developers, right? But it's providing a solution to how to prove the market validity of your product, right? Of your game, right? Through crowdfunding. But I make a point in the article that it's not necessarily about crowdfunding, that there's probably other ways to do this. And I basically say at the end, like, please, let's discuss it in the comments. If you can think of better ideas about how to prove that people will buy your game before you've spent all that time creating the game, then let's talk about other ideas too, because this could really help the indie games developer scene a lot right now. I think there's a lot of people that are hurting. I know I heard a lot when my last game, Hero Bash, flopped completely. You know, 2 years of my life, 20 grand I racked up in credit card debt, $5,000 spent on PR, and our game to this day never sold more than $50 in 1 month. And that's like the first month it made $50 profit. So to this day, I'm still in the red from that game. I'm hurting, right? And there's other indie developers like that too. And what do we have in common? We didn't verify that our game was something people wanted to buy before we spent those years of our lives. So we can't, you know, we might have learned lessons. Great. I'm cool with that. And I'm actually very excited that I learned that lesson, you know, but now I know how to do it right. And I want other people to be able to do it right from the beginning, right? Save some time. Let's save some time in our lives and actually, you know, make games that succeed. And ditch the ones that aren't going to succeed. Yeah, true. Yeah, you can put your... Yeah. But this is not going... This is not meeting the requirement. The requirement is you need to know if a person will buy the game. Not if they say they would buy it. I guarantee you, if you were to go put a website up if you were to go take a video game that you were created, right? You have a demo for your video game and you go ask 100 of your friends if they would buy this game, or you go ask complete strangers if they would buy your game. Most people are going to say yes, because they want you to like them, and they would feel guilty if you know, if they were to say no in that sense. But ask them to actually pony up cash and spend some money on your game, and now you've got a completely different situation. You know what I mean? So yes, yeah, getting on a Steam Greenlight concept page is a good thing, right? You verify if the concept in general is something people are going to accept and like, and is going to be sort of maybe a good thing for people. But it really does have to come down to the dollars of it all for people to really say what they really think about a game, I think. That's my opinion on it all. But I've never seen... You know what I mean? This is about proving that a game has validity, not sort of getting a feeling if it has validity, right? But good points, man. Really good points here. Rainbow Wolf, what's up? Malak Realak. Why did I choose Coco CDX? Because it's cross-platform and C++. What about the lack of documentation? I wrote a whole book on it. There's wizardfoo.com. Let me Yeah, I've been using it so long. I've been using Cocos 2DX so long that I'm already really, really familiar with it. So documentation really doesn't is not a big deal. Yes, same thing. Yeah, this is a great idea, right? This is a great idea for your game, putting your stuff on a TIG source devlog. Same thing with Steam's Greenlight concept page. These are actually essential things that you should be doing at the very beginning of a game, right? But I think it really does have to come down to that. Asking people if they would buy. No, not asking people if they would buy, but asking people to buy. Yeah, that is actually a pretty big obstacle, right? And it always has been with Cocos 2DX. They've never been great about documentation. And whenever they upgrade, there's always things that break, you're like, damn, I got to go fix like nine new errors because Cocos 2DX has changed again. So, but if you can deal with those issues, it's a really great because it's open source. That's also a big reason why I use Cocos 2DX. It's completely open source and completely MIT licensed, which is a great thing for portability. So as you go and you want to port your game to PlayStation, for example, the MIT license is an important thing. Nice, man. Yeah, killer KO. I agree. Making a good game is important, but what if a good game is not enough to make a game a success, right? You have to define what that means for you, right? Like, does success to you have anything to do with finance, right? Does success include a financial success? If it doesn't matter that it's this financial success then yeah, you have different priorities. So I'm talking about indies that need to actually survive off of making games, right? This is what we do for, this is what I'm doing for a living right now. This is paying my bills. So making a good game is a great thing for me in my heart and what I want to do as a developer, but does it pay the bills? There's also that side of it, for me at least. Yeah, you can, right? There's so many reasons why that game basically flopped. But I kind of think it looks like a really well put together game myself. When I looked at the video and everything, I mean like, it looks good. I thought it looked good. But the same kind of thing, I wouldn't buy it, right? Therein lies the crux of the whole point of that article I'm writing is that, how to know that people will buy your game, if that matters to you. Yeah, that's nice. Oh, okay. Yeah. Nice. Right. Killer KO. This is a really good point here. This is a problem, right? When you've only got money on your mind, I've really got to make this point in the article, right? They do. They tend to create something that's centered on paying their bills rather than making choices based on what would be fun to play. But I would challenge this also. You can find both. And in fact, in a lot of cases, making a game that's fun to play is good business also in the indie games business, right? Right? That should be common sense, right? That making a game that's fun to play should be fundamental to paying the bills, right? Because people that have fun playing games pay money for them. But I see what your point is, and I get you right here that if you're making decisions too much based on, well, this will make money, then yeah, where's the art in it? Where's the fun? Where's the enjoyment of the process and all that? It's a good point to make. Oh. All right, so his arm's gonna be coming across. Well, that is like way too long of an arm. Okay, so the sword is also going to need to be rotated a little bit more. Something like that. Yeah, you should. Yeah, true, true. Right. But how, if we try and look at that scientifically, it's kind of a difficult thing to do because he already had some success from previous games, Super Meat Boy. He already had a following for his style of games, right? I'm talking about how does an indie that is just starting out prove that their game is going to be something people will buy? Edmund McMillen already had some success and already had some stuff, so it is kind of a lucky game that he created. But how can we create games that are fun for us to make and fun for us to play and prove that people are actually going to buy them, right? How can we succeed not only at creating fun games and having fun during the process, but actually succeed business-wise too, right? That's what I'm trying to do to talk about. Well, true, true, yeah. This is a good point. I like what you're saying here. I like your whole train of thought. He's got his own website. Well, I mean, it's up to you. Did you check out those articles I sent you on, or those videos from Extra Credits? Did I send you those? I would start with some Extra Credits before you even think about this. But if you check out Extra Credits, and you'll realize that you should start with the simple things. Definitely start with player movement and collisions, I would say. But it depends on you and your style, man. This is something you kind of have to answer for yourself, really. What do I prefer to do first? That's up to you. Yeah, you go like, you know what I used to do when I was like in a violent mood? I would go hit golf balls. It was way back when I was a kid in Oregon and stuff. Good question. What game do you know that you think should have succeeded but didn't? Good question. Has anybody got an answer to that? What was that? Think should have succeeded but didn't? That's a really good question. Can anybody come up with this, some examples? Huge energy! The Songbringer. What do you mean didn't? All right, man. Yeah, good night, man. Wizards, lizard. What's that one? Ooh, what's that little lizard? This looks very similar to Binding of Isaac. It looks like they released it in 2014, June 16th. Oh wait, this is a wizard's lizard. Wait. So oh. So yeah, what the hell? Where is this Wizard's Lizard 2 at right now? Canceled. All right, man. No worries, no worries. Yeah. So wait. Grim Fandango did pretty bad at release, but made good money on the Steam re-release. Ooh, good point. I don't know. That was kind of before we really had this indie scene, though. But yeah, that's a good example. Did it? Yeah, such a good game, right? Pigeons. Why is this fill not working? Contiguous. Of course, I want contiguous. Oh, I turned off contiguous at some point. Right. Okay, so this is kind of right. This is a really dirty document here. All jumbled up and stuff, but we got one frame where he's like, ah, and then another frame where he's like, bam. Kind of moving slowly. I'm making this arc. I've only got two frames sort of done. Man. Hello, Phantoser. Yes, I've been at Amsterdam. I love it. I love the Netherlands. Okay, there's got to be more energy on this thing, though. Right? If this thing's got that much energy, right? This is like world-ending type energy right here, man. I might have gone a little bit too ambitious for this for this piece of art. I don't know. I guess I have to see it in the game before I make that call, though. Can't remember any of it. Man, it's like this. I went to see Tool. It's like one of my favorite bands. And the last time I went and saw them, I don't remember seeing them at all. I know I was there, but I don't remember seeing Tool at all. It was kind of one of those concerts. Okay, so if we go a little more epic, let's see what it looks like. Gotta try this. Something like, bam, there's still some energy coming down. Why is it doing it again? Oh, there, that pixel. Yes, I use a tablet. You can't decide whether you like your workflow better when you use a tablet, really? For me, it's a clear win. I'm like, oh yeah. I definitely prefer the tablet. The actual art, you know, is just feels more like I'm actually creating art like I would on a piece of paper, you know? And I find that I'm a lot faster with the with using a tablet than I am with, you know, trying to use a mouse. I think a mouse just is not the tool of my preference for that. I don't know if I like this frame like this. I know it looked like one for a minute there. I was like, wait a minute. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I guess it really helps because I had a few years before of that. I started drawing, like just pens. You know, I use pens. Actually, my whole life really, I've done a lot of drawing and like stuff in little notebooks. You know, I always kind of doodled and stuff a little bit with the pen and with a pencil a little bit too, there at the end. But I always used to use black and red pens. And so I got used to freaking holding like this, you know, and I never would look at the, I would never ever look at the pencil. I would just more look at the art that was being created. And so maybe that helped to shape how, to make it easier when I started, for at least, you know, easier with the graphics tablet. Oh, and I forgot about the jib stash. But we've got the hat. And we've got rock. We got jib. Yeah, I agree. I agree. Yeah, get used to it. Yeah, it is slow goings getting used to these things. 'Cause they're weird at first. You're like, man, I gotta put my hand all the way down here for that and all the way up here for this. But once you're used to it, you can so much more. You can look how natural this is. Look at this. Yeah, getting used to it is really, really worth it, man. You know? Try it. Try it. Before you make the call for yourself, at least get used to the pen enough where it feels really natural, and then make the call what's better for your workflow, you know? Can I play Songwriter? Sure, no problem, man. Yeah, look at this. Got some song bringers to play. Where is this game right now? Dude, okay, I actually want to play with a controller. Let's see the hot swap. I'm pretty sure it hop swaps. Forgot whether I did that right or not during that theme. Oh yeah, totally. Oh yeah. You know what? It has been a minute since I actually played the game, especially with these the sword's not working. What the hell? Oh, there it is. It's working. Never mind. So I'm almost dead. Hopefully this isn't permadeath mode. Oh yes! Fake the grass! Yeah, this is actually really nice with diagonal movement, man. And the four items. I keep pressing the wrong button for the attack. I really need to work on that, because I'm going to make it so you can actually bind your sword to a different key. Right now, you have to have your sword on the letter A, or your A button, or whatever. So I'm going to make it so you can change that to whatever you want. Yeah, there's new sound on the stream. It should be recording the sound of my game at full quality instead of having to do it through my laptop speakers, which was because Open Broadcaster didn't work really, because it had this. I'm like, which button is the sword? Because I've been playing Axiom Verge so much. Axiom Verge is awesome. If you guys haven't played Axiom Verge and you like Metroid, check out Axiom Verge. No, this is a new thing, walking diagonal. Yeah. Thanks, Killer Co. Thanks, Mr. Laguma. Yeah, nice progress, right? Thank you. Thanks for saying that, because it really has helped a lot, right? There's four buttons now instead of two. So you can bind a lot more of your items and stuff to these different things. And man, I'm so excited for where this game is going to go in the next like 3 or 4 months, because there's going to be that's so bound wrong for my habits. The world is going to be divided into three different areas. So right now the overworld, oh man, the map broke. I did something to break the map. Oh well, but it's like The Legend of Zelda, where it's 16 areas wide and it's 8 areas high, and I'm keeping it constrained to that rectangle because I think it's cool and it's old school. So, but anyways, a third of those 16 by 8, there's actually 128 different areas on each overworld. So this is we're on the overworld right now. There's also dungeons if you haven't seen this game before. It's a lot like The Legend of Zelda. It's totally inspired by The Legend of Zelda. So, in those 128 areas, there's going to be, at least 9 dungeons and 3 main sections, right? There's already 4 different biomes going on with different art types and stuff. But there's actually going to be 3, we're going to think of these more as maze sections of the game. So, and they're going to require items to get into those sections. So, in the first section, you start out where you can pretty much go anywhere, right? You don't need any items to pass any gates or whatever. But the second and third sections are going to require some sort of item that you've obtained along the way to get into that section of the world, right? So for example, you might need the bombs to blow up some tiles or whatever, and those enable you to get at that whole section of the world and open up other dungeons and stuff like that. Or maybe you need this whole charge attack that I was just working on to like open up some kind of tile or something like that, you know? So that it's gonna be a lot more of an interesting world to play. Yeah, the water leap pads look weird. What's up, Red Squadron? Yeah, and Cursive Taylor, not really a devlog as in blogs, but yeah, I'm on TigSource, and yeah, just look on TigSource for Songbringer, but it's songbringer.com is really where you want to go. That has links to everything and is and has my devlog through GIFs. It's more like a GIF log. I don't really do any kind of blogging because it's just so time consuming, but I do this with the with daily live streaming. Yeah, there's going to be a day-night cycle, and there's also going to be rain. So yeah, there's going to be a lot more environmental effects going on that'll really make it feel like a different world. Yes, Colby, this is C++. Oops, when I changed all the camera, I forgot to check about dying. But yeah, so this is the game. If the map was working right now, it looks like I broke a lot of things lately. But the map's broken. So, but somewhere there's gotta be level one. Wait, it's the red. Oh yeah, there, it's the red thing. Okay, so if I go to the right and then down, but that doesn't sound as fun. Let's try going up first. Yeah, it's with Cocos 2DX, which uses OpenGL, yes. It's entirely a 2D game. There's no 3D at all. Oh, this might be the wrong way to go to try and get there. So that's B, huh? OpenGL free? Yeah. Yeah, it is. It's a standard. It's really what it is. It's just a standard for how to interface with graphics. So each graphics provider or whatever, you know, everybody that creates a graphics type device, right? You know, like a video card. Basically, everyone that creates video cards creates libraries. Wait, maybe I got this wrong. I don't know. I shouldn't be talking. OpenGL is free. Yep, it looks like I can't get there going this way. Yeah, there's newer things out there. There's Vulkan, and there's Metal for iOS, and is it for Mac too? Yeah, so you get the point, right? This is what this game's like. It's like Zelda. It's basically inspired by Zelda 1, but it's different. You know, it's procedurally generated. There's item crafting. There's a, you know, there'll be a lot of more differences too. And the, you know, there's artistic differences and things like that. But there'll be other actual mechanical differences too. But anyway, so that's Songbringer. I'm gonna go back to making the art now. There you go. Play the game a little bit. OpenGL is not part of the video card driver, is it? I don't think so. That's what I was wondering. I'm not sure. I'm not a total expert there. Why did I go with Coco Studio? I don't do use Coco Studio at all. You mean Cocos 2DX? Yeah, I'm using the engine called Cocos 2DX. And why would I go with that instead of something like Game Maker? This is a huge, great question to ask. But it does invite, you know, some opinions, right? Why am I not using Game Maker? In my opinion, I don't like using software to make a game. I mean, game library software, right? Game Maker is a piece of software that someone else compiled that makes a game for me. I'm a programmer at heart. I like to have access to the entire source code base. So I need something that's completely open source. Game Maker is not open source. And that goes for a lot of reasons, right? For one, you can go and change something. If there's something broken in your code base for making the game, you can go change it. You can fix it. Secondly, when you go to port it to platforms like PlayStation 4 or things like that, or Xbox, you're going to want to have the most open source libraries you have. Just trust me. You need a good licensing deal with the company that's making it. Or you can go with Unity or something like that, where they can actually already, I think they can already export to PlayStation, right? With Unity. Unity's actually a pretty badass engine. It's a pretty nice thing to use. But again, I don't prefer to use software, so that's why I'm not really a Unity user myself, or Unreal. Unreal's another great engine too. There's a lot of other great engines as well, but I prefer to use, I'm just kind of a DIY kind of guy. You know what I mean? I like to do it myself. And Cocos 2DX is pretty much a do-it-yourself type of engine. Can you shower in the waterfall? It should be. Yeah, right? That's OpenGL. This is what OpenGL is like, totally. Thanks, Exception. A hunger thirst system? Oh, no. There's no actual hunger thirst system. He was just saying that. Yeah, they've been enemies. Yeah. Right, yeah, Nefarian. Thanks for clarifying that. Yeah. Ah, okay. Is Java open source? Yes, I think so, right? It's totally open source, right? Okay, so here's the frame I'm not really happy with. This frame, kind of cool, right? But maybe a little too big. I'm not sure if this... this might be too big. So this one, though, it's just not getting... It's not the oomph yet, right? So I was thinking maybe the oomph was going to be when he hits the ground. Right? But maybe not. Oh, man, I have not made much good progress today. How long have I been streaming and all I got is two frames here? Bah, c'est la vie. What's up, Spymort? Oh, okay. I'll take a look at that. Right? That's what I was wondering. No, I'm not using Cocos Studio. I'm using Cocos 2DX. I don't use Cocos Studio. I don't use software. Cocos 2DX, it's an engine. It's just source code. You get this, it's source code. You compile it, your game runs on it. There's no software. Yeah? Why? Is there people that are not like that? Yeah, that's what I was thinking, right? Yeah, I'm not a Java expert either, so I don't really know. I can't really say for certain on that kind of stuff. So that's one of the great things about streaming, is that we can all kind of like collaborate together with our knowledge and stuff. No, like he just said here, it's not actually more powerful. It's the same thing. Cocos Studio is built with Cocos Studio. And when you create a project in Cocos Studio, all you're doing is creating where the assets go and things like that. And then it creates a Cocos 2DX project for you. And then you go and compile your Cocos 2DX project and run it to test it, right? Cocos Studio is this thing where it's like an environment, like a piece of software that creates your game. And I don't use that because I don't want that. What's the one thing Unity couldn't handle? Yeah, there you go. Yeah, we can wild guess too. I do that a lot. I'm a wild guesser. Okay, oh man, so let's try this another way. Let's think of it. Right, if this thing, if this background. Wait, without this gray. Right, if we got more of this huge effect going on here. I don't know if this is gonna work though. No, I haven't played, but it looks awesome. Yeah, exactly. You're creating like a UI and stuff for your game. Yeah, I understand that. I understand that. But it hasn't ever gotten that way. I thought that would happen like around the Kickstarter phase, around day 120, when there were so many people watching the stream and stuff. And it's always stated about that level. There's always been maybe a max 50 people watching this at once, from what I understand. I don't know. I've never clicked this really, but people have told me, hey, there's 50 people on right now. What do I gotta do to show how many viewers there are? Oh, see, there's how many viewers are there now? I don't know, 30? Can't count that fast. Have I seen this game? Nuclear Throne, of course. Of course, man. Oh. Was this Unity 5 or 4? Yeah, right? It's sweet. I love text-based games because I grew up in that era where that's about what it was like when we started, right? When I was a kid, we had text-based games which were cool to play, like Zork. Oh, with Unity 5, huh? Okay, so yeah, but yeah, this is exactly Dylan why I only stream a couple hours a day because I can only chat for so long, and then so but I like this. I like interacting with you guys, and I teach you things sometimes. Sometimes you teach me things. It's a really give and take relationship because I'll be making some art or whatever here, and then I'm also getting feedback on the art, or like. There's a lot of other great examples of just getting this direct, amazing feedback. So it's valuable to me, it's valuable to you. And so I just kind of go at whatever speed people are at rather than trying to always be like, oh, I got to get so much done during the stream. But, I was just thinking that just a second ago. What's up, Avendable? Nice. Yeah, Rain World, that looks like such a rad game. I love the look of that game. I love their water and everything in Rain World. Man, that's some cool stuff. Okay, so if maybe if it wasn't quite so epic. Something more like this. Thanks, man. Yeah, I agree. I agree. Stick with an engine. You'll get to your game. You get is the point for you to write a game engine, or is the point for you to write a game? You got to decide that. If you really want to make a game, don't spend, I would recommend not even creating your own engine. But if your goal is to make an engine and you want to learn about how games are made, then make an engine, man, and make it awesome. But you can do both too. You can also make your own engine and make your own game. And sometimes it is totally necessary. But in a lot of cases, I don't know. I think learning an engine is a valuable thing, and using somebody else's, I think it saves a lot of time. But that's a debate. You know what I mean? Everybody has their own opinion about that. Is this too much? Right? Is this too big of an effect? I guess I have to put this in the game to even try this. Let's do it. Okay, let's start coding something. I'm gonna try and put this frame and this frame into an animation real quick. It's not even gonna look right at all, but we'll see if this is too big. Gotta dial in these proportions before I commit too much more time. Nice. Yeah, totally. Yeah, see there, we got to put this in the game to decide that. Nice. I know where this is, right? Isn't this? Wait. Where'd you take this? The motion is that it goes down, right? It goes from where it is up to down. But I'm just dialing proportions before I do the motion. This is going to be the charged up attack. Anywhere. It's anywhere. Cool. Okay, so let's code this up a little bit so we can get two frames of this and see if it's too big. Okay, so the first thing we're gonna need, we already got it hooked up in the man, I already pretty much hooked a lot of this up already, so we don't need to do much, shouldn't have to do as much coding. I thought it was. How do you become a moderator? There's really no official process. You have to be a little spoon. Yeah. Where is this? Okay. We've got the item already. Let's see if we can even load that item. Wait, where? Okay, in component, we need to at least make sure the item's hooked up. Yeah, we got charge. Item, it's gonna be look like the item blink for now. It's gonna be called charge. Yeah, this like is actually hooked up enough to actually work. So let's give that player the charge item. And now we need to hook it up so it can be used. So in the system for running items and effects and things like that. Input system. We'll create a function for using it. Oh, it's gonna be a lot like Vel's item, the telekinesis hat or telekinesis palm. Use item palm. This thing charges up and then dispels energy. So be a lot like that. You charge up this attack, let go of it, and bam. So let's create a function for running this. Use item charge. Let's hook up that function in the list of functions, the map of functions and all that. Use item dash, you guys item charge. There we go, now it's usable, and let's just customize it a little bit so you are actually running that animation and all that. So we get a dir, starting a shot, lens pushing effect. That's if the gear is ready. Otherwise, if it's not, it charges up. Okay, yeah. So this is where it unleashes, right? It runs the effect, and this is where it's charging up the effect. So we need to also hook up the animation. So assets, profiles, rock. We need the animation for charging and for dispelling or what, letting loose, whatever. Charge attack, I guess. Format rock charged. I think it's charged, right? Charged. Yeah, charge sword east. East zero is gonna be just the charge a frame for now, no animation. And then attack is where we got one frame like that, where he does both of those are gonna be a tenth of a second by default. And let's run that animation. So this sets the gear to ready. This is creating the actual string name for the animation. I guess we can just keep that simple like this. S is equal to charge. Charge. If we have the animation, we let go of it, clear the inputs direction, set the animation to that. Afterwards, we're going to run the animation for the charge attack. Move is locked. Next animation move is locked. Yeah. And then play the sound charge. Okay, this might work. And we don't need to set the skin though. Oh, it's a skyscraper, Burj Khalifa. How would I describe my game architecture? It's, oh man, this is down to the best thing I've learned how to do in making games lately. It's the Entity Component System, ECS. Check it out, man. It's definitely not event driven. It's an Entity Component System. Yeah. And that's I wrote this for Songbringer Entity Foo, and there's the link for it. Thanks, Marza. Wow, cool. So we should have the item. It should look like the blink. We should be able to use it. And I have no idea how this is going to look. But the point is to just see if the proportion, the size of this attack image is even right. So let's bind this one to X. Cool. Whoa. So you should have to have your sword out for this. I won't run it again. Let's see if it runs it again when we have the sword. It's just not running it again. Weird. Something happened here to just make it break. Oh, we probably need to run some kind of... Oh, here it is. If the ID input set timer. And set the ready to false. Oh, and this, we don't need to run the second animation. Ah, this is the problem right here. We're going to want to go run this animation up here. Once we let it loose. Set timer and render the flags to for an end move locked, so we're move locked while we're doing this animation. But afterwards we run idle. Forever. And this is only done once. So no repeat. Both of these are move locked. This one we don't need the next one move locked. Charge. Just play this thing forever. So it should be zero. Yeah. Twitch installs Arch Linux. What? Hello, I'm a 48-year-old man from Somalia. Sorry, my bad English. I sold my wife for internet connection for install Arch Linux. I want to become the goodest installer like you. Right? Whoa, look at that. I forgot to make it semi-transparent so it would give, so it wouldn't have that, shadow. But now let's use it. Yeah, okay, it worked. Wait, why does it start like that now? It's not allowing me to charge it anymore. Ooh, sorry. I reset the chat window instead of running. I do this thing every time. Oh, that's right, we have BTTV now! Chat history, so cool. BTTV, you are awesome. Save, okay, let's save and quit. So I don't have to keep finding that. But anyways, okay. Point is to see if it's too big, and it's not. For a very brief moment of the, you know, this animation being how as tall and big as it is, it's fine. Okay, so that's fine. Yeah, I could totally design this animation being that big. All right, Gennaro Marza. Yeah. I've never tried Arch Linux. I've tried Slackware, and I kind of thought that was bare bones, but I'm sure if Arch Linux is as bare bones as you're saying, I can imagine getting a lot more bare bones. Yeah, are you really? Debian's awesome. I use it on my server, for sure. I love Debian. I've used Slackware and Debian and Ubuntu and Red Hat back in the day. I liked Slackware back in the day, though. It's pretty cool. But I haven't had an Ubuntu installation in a minute. I got to get that going again. I've only had Windows 7 and... No way! Are you serious? They beat the whole game with Dark Souls? No way. Good night, Marza. See ya. Oh, really? Really? Actually, I gotta kind of get going soon, too. I'm all hungry now. As soon as I get hungry, it's like, I gotta stop the stream. How long have I been streaming, by the way? Well, I've done two very important things in the stream. I started a piece of art, and I got it in the game to the point where we can see if it's the right proportion. So, that's good. That's a lot for 2 hours. Yep, it's time to go. It's time to go. Really, has changed a lot since 7? I think the last one I had was 7. Cool. Oh, Oh, it was round based. The input with the most votes each 30 seconds was processed. Ah, very interesting. Oh no. Oh, dang, Arcane. I know, right? It's really hard. Are you talking about that first big boss guy in Dark Souls? Right, so tonight what I'm going to work on after I get some food and stuff. Wait, no, tonight's Halloween. Yeah, I'm probably not going to be able to do much more today. So yeah, this is where this is kind of going to end right now. This is sort of what this animation, right? The animation is going to be he has the sword in his hand. And he drops it straight on the ground, like, and kind of like squats a bit and hits the ground with a ton of force. And it creates an AoE effect, like a, just a little range type effect that hurts a bunch of enemies in a area around him, right? And also this item is going to be used for accessing different areas of the game. So there's going to be some blocks where you have to use this charge attack to break the block. That's the only way. So it'll kind of be a gate item too. Oh, those, yeah, I remember those stupid skeletons. They were kind of hard, right? Whoa, it's still live? Crazy. Thanks, Meriden. Do I recommend any pixel art animation tutorials? I don't have any in particular. But I recommend going and using and just watching a lot of speed pixel art. Go look up speed pixel art on YouTube or whatever and just watch a ton of it. That's what I recommend doing. Thanks, Azarus.